Airing first on Asheville FM, this is The Final Straw, a weekly anarchist, anti-authoritarian radio show broadcasting from occupied Soligi land in southern Appalachia. We bring you voices and perspectives from people, projects, and struggles around the world engaging in the long project toward liberation. This show is brought to you by Firestorm Books and Coffee. Located at 610 Haywood Road, Firestorm is a locally owned co-op specializing in offbeat, underground, and independent literature. You can find a sample of Firestorm's books and zines, plus a full calendar of events at their website, firestorm.coop. This week, we are pleased to present a paper given at the 2019 North American Anarchist Studies Network that took place this year in Atlanta, Georgia, by E. Ornelas, who presents a thoroughly de-colonial reading of Ursula K. LeGuin's novel, The Word for World is Forest. This book of LeGuin's was written in the early 1970s and was first published as part of the anthology, Again, Dangerous Visions, and subsequently published as a separate novella as part of LeGuin's Hainish cycle, to be read in a loose trilogy with her other novels, The Dispossessed and Left Hand of Darkness. As E. Ornelas states in their paper, this novella is not among LeGuin's most popular, but carries a very strong anti-colonial and anti-militaristic overtone, which was in part a reaction to the invasion of Vietnam by U.S. imperialist forces, also called the Resistance War Against America, which occurred from 1955 through 1973, and whose traumas and repercussions can be felt and seen to this day. This book was striking to me in the sense that it presents a worldview that starkly challenges that of colonial, quote, westernized minds through themes of an intense sensitivity to and interconnectedness with the environment and of the relationships with language, dreaming, and culture. What was great to me about this aspect to the story is that it shows very plainly the extent to which colonizers find illegibility, so-called illegibility, on the part of indigenous people to be deeply threatening, but can also be a pivotal place of strength, which with potentials all their own, and we can see this aspect in real life all around us as well. While I have my own problems with the book and would love to hear listeners' responses to it if they have them, it also gives me a sense of like a through line between past struggle and analysis all the way to now, an intergenerationality that we are sometimes lacking in as anarchists. I'd like to read a short quote from the introduction to the book by LeGuin, and this gives a little bit of a sense of why she wrote it and what was happening for her at the time. Quote, "All through the 60s in my home city in the States, I had been helping organize and participating in nonviolent demonstrations, first against atomic bomb testing, then against the pursuance of the war in Vietnam. I don't know how many times I walked down Alder Street in the rain, feeling useless, foolish, and obstinate, along with 10 or 20 or 100 other foolish and obstinate souls. There was always somebody taking pictures of us, not the press, odd-looking people with cheap cameras, John Birchers, FBI, CIA, crackpots, no telling. I used to grin at them or stick out my tongue. One of my fiercer friends brought a camera once and took pictures of the picture takers. Anyhow, there was a peace movement and I was in it, and so I had a channel of action and expression for my ethical and political opinions totally separate from my writing. In England that year, a guest and a foreigner, I had no such outlet. And 1968 was a bitter year for those who opposed the war. The lies and hypocrisies redoubled, so did the killing. Moreover, it was becoming clear that the ethic which approved the defoliation of forests and grain lands and the murder of non-combatants in the name of peace was only a corollary of the ethic which permits the despoliation of natural resources for private profit or the gross national product, and the murder of the creatures of the earth in the name of man. The victory of the ethic of exploitation in all societies seemed as inevitable as it was disastrous. It was from such pressures, internalized, that this story resulted, forced out, in a sense, against my conscious resistance. I have said elsewhere that I never wrote a story more easily, fluently, surely, and with less pleasure. End quote. And that's from the introduction to Ursula K. Le Guin's 1972 novel, The Word for World is Forest, which we're going to hear a talk on shortly. And after this talk, we're going to play some music commemorating the 20th anniversary of the WTO protests in Seattle, which occurred from November 30th through December 1st, 1999. But first, here are some words from anarchist prisoner Sean Swain. What you say, what you say, what you say,
I have a monumentally phantasmorific world-changing idea. If you're standing, you may want to sit down. If you're sitting, you may want to take yourself to your seat. I had every intention of keeping this grand swindle to myself for my own applications. But you know what? All of us dumpster-burning, ski mask-clad, machete-wielding, Molotov-chucking, savage cannibal maniacs got to stick together. So here it is. Ready? I've got two words for you. Wild boars. Wild boars are causing an epidemic of chaos and mayhem across the American Southwest. Have you seen these things? They're monstrous. They may get as big as 1,000 pounds, and they're mean as shit. Just hateful. Really aggressive. They've got tusks and teeth tearing apart just about anything. What I'm saying is, don't confuse these super predator pigs with the cute little pink variety you see cuddling with ducks and ferrets on YouTube. These things are rampaging through neighborhoods with reckless abandon, rooting through trash, and snatching up poodles and small kids right out of the yards. Don't pet the pig. Wherever this wild boar apocalypse spreads, city councils must scramble to locate an available wild boar whisperer to come in and eradicate this feral invasion. And I have to imagine, there are very few experts on the migration habits of wild boars. I also suspect that because the job is dangerous and because the infested cities require immediate help, the paycheck could be quite lucrative. So, that's where we come in. To carry out my plan, you're going to need a safari hat that makes you look like a wild boar expert and a pair of khaki shorts. And you're going to need a big, dumb chunk of land with a sturdy fence around it, probably somewhere like New Mexico, where you've got big, dumb stretches of nowhere down around where my parents live. No doubt you can squat a couple of acres. That is where you're going to breed the wild boars. So, once you've got that together, you head into the epicenter of the invasion. I'm sure the information is online somewhere. And you spend your nights with friends tracking down some of those wild boars. When you encounter them, don't kill them. You want them alive. Hit it with a tranquilizer dart, you know, from a blowgun, or maybe a crossbow, and then toss that boar in the pickup and drive like hell before the dope wears off. For tranquilizer, use carfentanil. You can find it anywhere on the streets of Cincinnati or Dayton. Wild boars will eat just about anything, so you can feed them by collecting up trash and tossing it over the fence to them. Provide water from a neighbor's garden hose. Run up their water bill, unless they're my parents. In the meantime, you present yourself in a safari hat and a khaki shorts to the city councils of all the major cities of the American Southwest, explaining how you are the world's most elite wild boar expert, and how you have spent decades tracking their migration patterns, and how this year is the perfect storm for wild boar infestations everywhere. Explain how this is the most evolved and dangerous breed of killer wild boars ever, and then give them your business card. The stage is set. Once you have enough boars in your pen, you rent a box truck, load them up, and drive them to Tucson or Tempe, Reno or Albuquerque. 3 a.m, release the boars. You can play your theme song on the boombox as you do it. Who let the hogs out? Within hours, your phone will be ringing off the hook. The hierarchs will pay you handsomely to pick up your own pigs. They won't even know what hit them. You are a hero as far as they know, with your safari hat and khaki shorts and exotic blowgun. They don't know it's a swindle, that you can blow a dog whistle or call the Boers by name and get them to rush right back into the truck for raw meat rewards. And then it's off to Phoenix or Austin. Fun times. You can use your mega millions for attacking the larger system in creative ways. And it all started with wild boars. You can even sell Who Let the Hogs Out t-shirts. But that's not the end of it. Oh no. When you spend enough time with the herd, you can figure out which ones are the smartest and begin training them. Show them photos of important political figures and corporate executives, training them to identify and target specific people. Wild boar assassins. Like the Treadstone and Blackbriar programs from the movies, only using pigs. Jason Boar. And so, when you unleash the beasts, as it were, some of those wild boars are dangerous trained killers carrying out a complex assassination program. There are some moral considerations here, of course, but can you imagine a wild boar assassin hopped up on meth? Just think of the upheaval, the mayhem, the social disruption. Drug-enhanced wild boars waging class war, eating bankers and governors and chiefs of police. And then, of course, your paycheck for rounding them up. It would all culminate when your herd finally descended on Washington, D.C. The White House, the Senate, the House of Representatives, the Supreme Court. All overrun by wild boar assassins geeked up on meth. Now, I'm almost out of time, so I can't go into detail about this, but I want to leave you with one final thought. Wild boar explosives training. This is anarchist prisoner Sean Swain in exile from Ohio at Buckingham Correctional in Dilwyn, Virginia. If you're listening, you are the resistance.
You can write to Sean Swain at his latest address at Sean Swain, number 2015638, Buckingham Correctional, P.O. Box 430, Dilwyn, Virginia, 23936. You can find his past writings, recordings of his audio segments, and updates on his case at seanswain.org, or now follow him on Twitter at Swain Rocks.
Hi, y'all. Good morning. I'm here in Ornelas, for they, them, for pronouns. If I talk like this, can you all hear me? So I'm going to talk a little bit about a paper I call If We Wait, It Is We That Will Be Burned, Exploring Violence and Resistance, and Ursula LeGuin's The Word for Willis Forest. But first, I want to start by acknowledging that I researched and wrote this paper on ancestral Dakota land, and I'm now presenting it on traditional Muscogee Creek land, communities that have been forcibly removed and continually disenfranchised by white supremacist settler colonialism. And while my ancestors are indigenous to what is now known as Central Mexico and also arrived as settlers from Southern Europe, I enter into this work with decolonial, abolitionist, anti-racist, feminist, and queer of color praxis in my heart. In the introduction to Octavia's Brood, Walita Imarisha explains that whenever we try to envision a world without war, without violence, without prisons, without capitalism, we are engaging in speculative fiction. Using this perspective as inspiration, I also hold the reverse to be true. Whenever we engage in speculative fiction, we are engaging a world beyond what we believe to be and have been told is possible. I am particularly inspired by social science fiction literature and how it can help to envision an anti-racist, feminist, decolonial, anti-carceral futurity. As Anishinaabe scholar Grace Dillon points out, science fiction provides, quote, a valid way to renew, recover, and extend First Nations peoples' voices and traditions. At the same time, Dillon reminds us that science fiction has often been the site of furthering harmful colonial notions about indigenous peoples. Like Dillon, I too am concerned with the misrepresentations that science fiction enables, while also maintaining that science fiction is a useful method about speculating what could be. Specifically, I'm interested in the possible opportunities and obstacles to resistant violence that Ursula Le Guin encourages us to imagine in the 1972 novella, The Word for Willis Forest. In this presentation, I will offer several interpretations of this novella, including an indigenous feminist lens on the text, as well as thoughts on its estimation of violence and resistance. By and large, the scholars who have critically engaged with The Word for Willis Forest are white, non-indigenous cis men, who have failed to account for decolonial indigenous feminist considerations. While I will not directly discuss their works, and actually my citational practice intentionally centers indigenous women and women of color, and omits largely white cis men, in order to address their oversights, at least, I am informed by the concept of spatial injustice or spatial justice from Seneca Nation scholar Mishwana Goman. I am also compelled by an imperative to rethink violence and resistance and end my presentation with a meditation on the problematics of how resistant violence is constructed in the word for world is forest and beyond. So my conception of resistant violence is analogous to what Jean Amaury defines as revolutionary violence in a Fanonian or decolonial sense, in that it achieves, quote, the affirmation of the self-realizing human being against the negation or against the denial of the human being, end quote. Similarly, Mississauga Anishinaabeg writer Leanne Simpson insists that resistance in the form of direct action, even if it's not violent, is affirming, strengthening, and transformative. So how does LeGuin speculate about resistant violence? Or in other words, what does the word for world is forest allow us to imagine as possible options for and limits to a kind of violent resistance in the face of spatial injustices of colonization? What does the author create as resistant action instead of safest forms of redress like the criminal justice system? And how can speculative fiction like this inspire present-day responses to violence and oppression? While there are many points of entry into LeGuin's The Word for World is Forest, I want to make an argument about the connection between the violence that's perpetrated against certain characters and how this shapes the resistant violence these characters in turn perpetrate. So unfortunately, the author sheds a rather unsympathetic light on resistant violence, because as readers, it becomes easier to sympathize with the colonized subjection to the will of their colonizers than the colonized resistance, the violent resistance to their subjection. So in other words, we can sympathize with their experience of violence under colonization, but not the path they take to resolve it. How LeGuin's colonized characters choose to fight violence leads us to believe that by the act of resisting violently, they themselves will continually perpetuate violence and murder. I find this message somewhat unhelpful when imagining possibilities for redress beyond the logics of the carceral state. Particularly dangerous is the inclination to evaluate violent bodies, beliefs, and behaviors as erroneously or inappropriately resistant. And I wish to challenge and subvert this rather unsympathetic attitude towards resistant violence in this work to seriously consider anti-carceral abolitionist responses to violence on our own planet. So I'm assuming a lot of you probably haven't read The Word for World is Forest. It's not LeGuin's most popular book, so I'll give some background. So bear with me. I hope that I can give enough context for all of this for folks who haven't read it. The Word for World is Forest takes place on Achi, which is a densely wooded planet inhabited by a native intra-species non-aggressive humanoid population, a portion of which who have been captured, enslaved, and tortured under the resource extraction project of colonizers from Terra, or what is our Earth. While a handful of scholars have written about the eco-critical aspects, the role of indigenous characters, and utopianism and dystopianism within the book, these topics have generally been regarded in isolation from one another and lack sufficient engagement with feminists, particularly indigenous feminist theory. First, I will explore this book with the help of the indigenous feminist literary analysis of Mishwana Goman. So the violence that takes place at the hands of Terrans in The Word for World is Forest operates on multiple levels, insofar as Achi embodies at all scales, individual, communal, and geographic, and the effects on them are completely inseparable. The Terran colony resident anthropologist, Dr. Raj Leibov, understands this in reporting to visiting emissaries in the novel. Quote, a forest ecology is a delicate one. If the forest perishes, its fauna may go with it. The Achian word for world is also the word for forest. I submit that though the Terran colony may not be in imminent danger, the planet is, end quote. As Leibov's quote demonstrates, the world or physical planet is co-constitutive of the forest and the flora and fauna within it. And within this colonial apparatus and destructive resource extraction, multiple manifestations of violence arise in the form of destabilization of kinship networks through forced relocation of slave labor, the disruption of Achaean ways of living with and in the world slash forest, as well as the verbal, psychological, physical, and sexual assault on Achaean bodies. Echoing Goman, LeGuin tells a story in which Achaeans, their community relations, and their connections to the land are severed and controlled by colonization. Goman establishes that Chickasaw author Linda Hogan's novel Solar Storms, quote, asserts a scale of time and space based on connection, thus collapsing the settler scale that separates humans, land, animals, and so on. So Goman explains the colonization of so-called Canada and the United States produces relationships that are regarded as discrete, distinct, separate from one another. So in contrast to this, Goman urges settler colonial studies to, quote, examine spatial injustice and native feminist practices that enable us to delve more deeply into the ways that gendered and sexualized violence has multiple connections that spread out on a vertical and horizontal scale, end quote, across temporal and spatial planes through multiple generations. So these spatial injustices, or the multiple connections that Goman delineates, are exactly what I want to turn to when pondering the work for Golda's Forest. I think spatial injustice helps us to see that the events in LeGuin's novella are not separate, but all part of the same process of colonization on Athshean. Terran violence against individual Athshean bodies are representative of colonization and environmental degradation, and conversely, these structures compose the very circumstances that make individual and communal experiences of violence possible. As part of the spatial injustice enacted in the novella, there are instances of forceful starvation, verbal debasement, menial and grueling working conditions, and sexual violence such as rape and public castration. These individual acts of sexual violence are directly linked to the broader process of colonization, since Terrans mark Athshean bodies as expendable in the same way that they mark communities and land as expendable. As Goman suggests, the pain of colonization is not merely experienced by individuals alone, right, these separate discrete entities, but in fact, quote, native women's bodies also become the conduit of possible violence that reinforces settler structures of violence, end quote. What I would say against all human and more than human bodies at all levels. So while much of the sexual violence in the book is alluded to, there's at least one instance that exemplifies the spatial relationships between interpersonal community and ecological violence. Captain Davidson, a Terran commander of a logging camp and the book's primary antagonist, sexually assaults and subsequently kills Thele, the wife of the book's Athshean protagonist, Selber. So LeGuin doesn't afford the reader an account of this from Thele's perspective, but Selber's narration of the event provides an insight into these spatial connections. As Selber relates to the heads of Kadas and Athshean town as yet unaffected by colonization, quote, "My city was destroyed by the humans when they cut down the trees in that region. I was one of those made to serve them with my wife Thele. She was raped by one of them and died. I attacked the human that killed her," end quote. At first, Selber's retaliation against, quote, "the human that killed her" appears to originate from Thele's rape, but upon closer inspection, Selber's indication in the same breath that Terrans destroyed tracts of land and enslaved Athshians denotes multiple manifestations of spatial injustice. As Selber's comments also allude, Terran deforestation and enslavement precipitated the forcible relocation of Athshians and destabilization of their traditional kinship networks. In this exchange, Selber arrives at Kadas in ill health and seeking refuge, and proceeds to inform the villagers of previous communities encountered, each one razed to the ground, and their people rounded up and made to serve Terrans through what in the book is called a voluntary autochthonous labor corps. It's not voluntary, obviously. Not only that, but Terrans also segregated the Athshean slaves by perceived sex, a practice unknown to Athshians, a society in which gender parity is the norm. Thus, Terran colonization operates through multiple registers of violence, seeking to order a wild space by clearing land of both Athshean people and other living things for Terrans' use. Captain Davidson remarks that if Athshi were, quote, "cleaned up and cleared out, the forests cut down for open fields of grain, the primeval murk and savagery and ignorance wiped out, it would be a real paradise, a real Eden," end quote. Thus, Davidson associates altering the physical and psychological landscape for resource extraction with cleaning out and removing Athshean bodies of all kinds, as well as wiping out savagery and ignorance by assimilating the planet's people into Terran norms of, for instance, compulsory labor and forced gender roles. Terran's assumption that Athshians are non-aggressive, ignorant, subhuman creatures that will not fight back against this resource extraction and degradation of their world and forest leads to the justification that the land and everything on it is for controlling in the name of colonial economic necessity. With Davidson using verbs like clean up, exterminate, get rid of, and wipe out to render Terran actions, LeGuin draws comparisons between not only Athshean land and people, but also between Athshean and Terran ways of life. Although some Afghan cities are far away enough that they remain just out of reach of Terrans, those Afghans who are captured end up having their relations to each other, as well as with their world/forest, drastically altered.
This is the Final Straw Radio Show, airing first on Asheville FM, WSFM LP 103.3 FM in Asheville, North Carolina. I'm your host, William Goodenough. You are listening to a talk given earlier this year by E. Ornelas about the anti-colonial potentials of the book The Word for World is Forest, written in 1972 by anarchist sci-fi author Ursula K. LeGuin.
In addition to the attempts to segregate and indoctrinate the Afghans, Terrans also house them in pens, which is, quote, not a good place for the mind, end quote, according to Selber. Furthermore, Terran colony encampments, described by Davidson as orderly and neat, thanks to Terran colonists who tamed a fair patch of wilderness, are actually just gated compounds completely disconnected from the outside Afghan world, flesh forest, and its people. Living isolated from their human and more than human community, the enslaved Afghans are forced to participate in demanding and humiliating labor that advances Terran colonization and exploitation of the planet. So this is not to say that Afghans are complicit in this violence, but rather that being separated from their people and the world flesh forest, while also being driven to quietly serve those who enact this violence, is a form of violence in and of itself. Therefore, the colonization that occurs in the Word for World is Forest is psychologically, sexually, physically, and ecologically violent in inseparable ways. I think LeGuin, even as a radical social science fiction author, fails to articulate violence as a valid tool for resisting these interconnected oppressions and achieving spatial justice, lest it taint an otherwise peaceful people and world/forest. So likely because she is a cis white woman and the child of anthropologists who research indigenous peoples, LeGuin's ideal resolution appears to be reliant on ideas of interventions from benevolent allies or saviors. LeGuin positively depicts people like Leibov's sympathy for Selber or colonial administrators' considerations of Afghan concerns, and even the eventual Terran departure at off-world emissaries' request, not the Afghans' request. However, for Goman, spatial justice is actually, quote, a model of material redistribution that ensures the life of native peoples, as well as dismantling the settler state's decision-making process, end quote. Both of which these things entail continually considering all bodies, individual, communal, and geographic, and the impacts of violence on them. Although LeGuin effectively connects the multiscalar impacts of colonization throughout this book, I argue that resistant violence is not a corruption of the Afghans, but rather than an appropriate avenue for redress, dismantlement, and redistribution in the novella. Indeed, Afghans justify resistant violence by making the case that it is necessary in order to remove Terrans so that they no longer cause harm. As a warning to Terran colonizers, the Afghans torch a logging camp, killing over 200 Terrans within it. Selber declares the violent removal of Terrans is a protective measure, and this is where the title of the paper comes from. Quote, they must be made to leave the forest because they are dangerous. If they will not go, then they must be burned out of the lands, as nests of stinging ants must be burned out of the groves of cities. If we wait, it is we that will be smoked out and burned, end quote. In this scene directly following the first coordinated attack on Terrans, Selber is speaking with Afghan elders and other villagers who have not been privy to the horrors of encampment life. Selber paints an extensive and urgent picture of the enslavement and clear-cutting that's taken place in the hopes of galvanizing others into action. But what's telling about Selber's words is the direct correlation made between Afghan inaction and their eventual demise. That's to say that if Afghans do not take immediate steps, although it's not explicit if these steps need to be murderous, if they don't take immediate steps, then they will only continue to suffer at the hands of Terrans. Comparing Terrans to stinging ants, for example, like a seething swarm of unfeeling drones, Selber makes the case that they're so dangerous they can barely be reasoned with, let alone impeded or expelled without drastic measures. Therefore, I see Selber's call for Afghan violence, for Terrans to be burned out of the lands, as a means of resisting further Terran violence. While their original intention seemed to be merely to expel colonizers from the world/forests, Afghans nevertheless kill Terrans when they burn down the logging camp. The Afghans are acting in a manner, therefore, in which they never have before. which is violently, through a, quote, new word, the deed, murder, end quote. By this new word or deed, Akshian's learned capacity for violence and even enmity. An Akshian headwoman named Tuntar uses the Akshian term Sha'ab to refer to Selvar, which means both a god and a translator, as both have the power to envision a word or deed and speak it into existence. So Selvar, as the Sha'ab, translates dreamtime visions of violence into worldtime actions. And it's not until through dreaming Selvar makes sense of the oppression that Akshian's face that it becomes possible to translate violent resistance into the world. Were Akshians to only dream of fire and death, but not bring them into fruition, they may remain unchanged as a people. If they do speak them into existence, and thus change from the very root of their subconscious, from their dreams. So translating dreamtime violence into worldtime actions precipitates a new word or deed that alters Akshians, and questions arise as to where this word even originated from, and what the long-term impacts of this might be. So it's clear that this new word or deed has the capacity to shift Akshians at their root, but it should be noted, interestingly, in the text, Selvar is the speaker of this new word, the one that dreams of resisted violence and manifests it, not Terran colonizers. So LeGuin says, quote, Selvar has brought a new word into the language of his people. He had done a new deed, end quote. LeGuin then exhibits resisted violence as the offending act, not just colonization. In the word for world is forest, although colonization is the impetus that necessitates resistant violence, it's the violence itself that modifies Akshian consciousness and behavior. However, LeGuin complicates whether the word or deed of violence is in fact Selvar's at all, as Leibov doubts. Had Selvar learned to kill his fellow men among his own dreams of outrage and bereavement, or from the undreamed of actions of the strangers? Was he speaking his own language, or was he speaking Captain Davidson's? That which seemed to rise from the root of his own suffering and express his own changed being might in fact be an infection, a foreign plague, which would not make a new people of his race, but would destroy them. End quote. Here, violence is still a force that would not make a new people, but would destroy them. But at the same time, the destruction is caused by an infection, a foreign plague, the disease of colonization. So is Selvar's response to spatial injustice merely a product of an internalized colonization? Or would Akshians have utilized a different, potentially less violent or non-violent form of resistance if it had not been for Terran's violence in the first place? Regardless of the motivations, LeGuin still poses Akshian resistant violence as unavoidably negative. As an inherently peaceful civilization, it's precisely because of their non-violence that the reader might be concerned about the impacts of the use of resistant violence on the Akshian peoples and their psyche. It is assumed that Akshian society, because there is no murder prior to Terran contact, is idyllic as well as unchanging, pre-modern, even primitive, given that it's been untouched by off-worlders up until this point. Leibov, as the only Terran who befriends an Akshian, typifies this idolization when imploring Selvar, quote, you must not go on killing other men. You must go back to your own, to your roots, end quote. So Leibov here is expressing anxiety about Akshians growing too far from their roots, implying that any transformation that strays from their essentialized past is destructive. The new word or deed of violence seemingly pulls Akshians further away from their romanticized pre-colonial cultural formation. Even if Akshians desired a return to their pre-colonial roots as a sort of decolonization, Leibov's sentiment suggests that to do so, they must avoid reproducing Terran forms of violence and oppression. Hence, if killing other men is coded as Terran, then decolonizing Akshian minds and actions is possible, but not through violence. Leibov's demand for Selvar and the other violently resistant Akshians to, quote, go back to your roots, assumes that violence is inherently colonial and cannot be used to resist or else it will destroy them. So obviously the problem with Leibov's demand to go back to your roots is that it is impossible to unlive colonization and return to a pre-colonial past. Even Selvar initially miscalculates the steps needed for decolonization to happen when replying to Leibov's comments, quote, when your people are gone, then the evil dream will stop, end quote. So here, Selvar seems to accept that the physical removal alone of Terrans will be enough to make the evil dream stop. But by the final scene, however, Silver reevaluates and concludes that even if Terran colonizers leave, Atchians may not be able to return to an idealized pre-colonial past when admitting, quote, there is no use pretending now that we do not know how to kill one another, end quote. Lebanon, an emissary from the planet Hain, who oversees the eventual withdrawal of all Terrans and redesignation of Atchi as a non-colony, optimistically claims, quote, we shall go, and within 2 days we shall be gone, all of us forever, and then the forests of Atchi will be as they were before, end quote. Silver rejects Lebanon's optimism, retorting, quote, maybe after I die, people will be as they were before I was born and before you came, but I do not think that they will, end quote. Silver understands that even though Terrans will physically leave, the residue of colonization will remain. Acknowledging the enduring legacy of colonization on indigenous populations is not to be construed as a sign of acquiescence or resignation. Silver's statement that Atchians now know how to kill one another is less a tacit approval or prediction of future violence on Atchi, and more a matter-of-fact assertion that violence is made possible, though not commensurably, through both the oppressive regime of Terran colonization as well as Atchian acts of resistance. So while on the one hand, this is a story of utterly changed individuals, communities, and landscapes under colonization, it's also a warning against the use of violence as a tool for resistance. In The Word for World as Forest, LeGuin depicts violence as a possible stain on the innately nonviolent and thus seemingly pure characters, rather than as a legitimate response to spatial injustice. Reading this less as a cautionary tale against colonization and more likely as one against resistant violence as a contaminant, I fear LeGuin imposes a polemic about respectability. Therefore, reframing violence in the face of colonization as resistant violence specifically highlights the conduct of the characters in this work of speculative fiction is not caused by some irredeemable or inescapable flaw at their root, but is in fact a reaction to being subjected to spatial injustices of physical attacks, sexual assault, severing of kinship ties, ecological degradation, and enslavement. This reframing also counters the subsequent impulse to regulate bodies, minds, and behaviors that need fixing in order to be properly nonviolent in their resistance. Obviously, no real-world situation neatly fits the parameters of this parable, so the book is not a one-for-one comparison about a specific act of colonization on our non-fictional Earth. Yet I think we can still infer meaning from the resistance of our literary analogs to strategically speculate beyond the limits of our known world. For example, I think there are parallels to Leanne Simpson's discussion of respectability politics within the Idle No More movement. Quote, segments of the movement were decidedly against direct action because it makes Canadians angry. The assumption is that we lose their support, and in some cases because it was seen as incompatible with Aboriginal culture. There's an assumption that if I act nicely, calmly, and happily, Canadians will support me because it's the right thing to do, end quote. I think LeGuin's novella presents a comparable dilemma. Indigenous resistant violence is divisive for colonizers who supposedly might otherwise be sympathetic. Moreover, a violent native does not fit the narrative of the stoic, peaceful, noble savage that settlers have concocted and want to cling to. Rejecting these appeals to nicely, calmly, and happily making claims under the watchful eyes of colonizers, Simpson encourages direct action as an affirmation, a strengthening, and a transformation, as a rejection of the settler state's monopoly on violence, and a reframing of indigenous peoples not as wronged victims, but embodied demands. Or to return to Silver's point, resistance gives the possibility for survival. In other words, both inaction and resistance may result in death, but at least resisting affords a chance to continue to exist. Once we accept that although violence is not harmless, that it also has potentially redemptive effects, we may find it easier to reject a politics of respectability in our own lived resistances. These kinds of contextual considerations are crucial when evaluating the utility and limitations to violence as a form of resistance, and I think speculative fiction assists us in contemplating these kinds of complicated cautionary tales. Engaging with speculative fiction then becomes a way to explore the project of resistance in the face of violence and oppression, and to think for ourselves what might responses to spatial injustice look like beyond the personal state, for example. Despite the limitations of LeGuin's novella, The Word for World is The word for world as forest allows us to imagine extra legal resistance against colonial violence, so that we may further interrogate the statist and carceral ideologies that limit our imaginative capacities and requires us to speculate about what else could be.
That was E. Ornelas with their paper, If You Wait, It Is We That Will Be Burned, exploring violence and resistance in Ursula Le Guin's The Word for World is Forest. You can find the full text of this book up at the Anarchist Library online, and we will post a link to that in our show notes. And now we will play some music to round out the hour. Both of these tracks were found on a 2003 compilation for attendees of the WTO protests in Cancun, Mexico. If you're interested in learning more about the protests, check out writings up at crimethink.com. There's a video up there called Breaking the Spell with tons of original footage. It's way more legit than the BS liberal star-studded movie called The Battle of Seattle. The two songs are Eugene the Anarchist First by Desert Rat, a socialist songwriter parodying the menacing media coverage of insurrectional anarchists from Eugene and other places in the Pacific Northwest in the run-up to and following the 1999 WTO protests. And then next up is PSA No. 12 by the Infernal Noise Brigade. This doomy marching band was known to show at large demonstrations and percussively stoke the fires of revolt with their horns, drums, and dark xylophones. Before the music, though, here is a short announcement. So there has been recently been attempts by ICE and DHS to investigate radical groups in Asheville. This scrutiny is coming amid an escalating pattern of ICE and DHS presence and terrorism all across North Carolina, some of which we have covered on this show before and has been all over the media elsewhere as well. Since its inception in 2002, ICE has continued a trend of targeted and racist oppression, and as it stands, it is the largest investigative branch of DHS. This past month saw opposition to ICE in Raleigh, where ICE Director Albance was being hosted along with acting Homeland Security Wolf in a press conference given by the Republican speaker. The group Never Again, which is a Jewish group formed to counter ICE violence with a specific aim to oppose the systematic dehumanization, which is the cornerstone of how ICE operates, is holding a month of actions all around the country this December. More about that at neveragainaction.com. And Asheville is no different. We have seen an increase in ICE and DHS all over this town. Here's a statement on behalf of the newly formed group Asheville Anti-Repression, which was developed to deal with this situation. Quote, Asheville Anti-Racism was recently alerted to the existence of an investigation being conducted by Immigration and Customs Enforcement and the Department of Homeland Security on November 4, 2019. RiseUp.net received a subpoena requesting any and all records or information related to names, addresses, phone numbers, email addresses, IP addresses, MAC addresses, payment information for the following email, AshevilleAntiRacism@RiseUp.net. RiseUp responded to the request on October 21, 2019, indicating that they do not keep records of the information that was requested and that they planned on notifying the account by email after 1 week of the existence of the subpoena. ICE is a threat to our communities regardless of whether you are a citizen or not. We maintain the position that ICE should be abolished and will continue to push back against this investigation. There are no individuals named in the subpoena, and we do not know the reason for this request. With the knowledge of the existence of the investigation, we bring you a reminder to not talk to agents of law enforcement. Please take care in the ways that you discuss this investigation as to not endanger yourselves or others. Speculation, gossip, and rumors can only harm yourself and your communities. We do want people to not feel afraid to continue to work together, to act, and to stand up for their ideals for a world without borders. Please take time to make sure you have access to an attorney and to refresh yourselves on your legal rights, security culture, and technological security practices. If you need access to more resources, to a lawyer, or if you are approached by an agent, please send an email to AshevilleAntiRepression@riseup.net. A reminder that we are not lawyers and cannot offer any legal advice. Additionally, please do not disclose sensitive information in an email to us. We will connect you with an attorney so you can confidently discuss the details of your situation. End quote.
Well, you've all heard about him. The media's raving about him. And whether you love him or whether you hate him, you have to admit, he sure did a lot for just one guy. Come and gather round, my people, tell the children not to cry. Bid them listen to my banjo and the story I will tell of a great and gallant hero who did spit right in the eye of our tyrannous oppressors on the day he gave 'em hell. So here's to Eugene the anarchist, who ran the World Trade Organization out of town. Oh yes, three cheers for Eugene the anarchist, that single-handed warrior who shot the bastards down. He was dressed in ragged trousers, and their color, it was black. How long he had been wearing them, you'd never want to ask. And a circle with an A inside was painted on his back. In his hand he held a hammer, on his face he wore a mask. He arrived upon the day when all the tyrants tried to meet, and they cowered in their hotel room so fearful of his wrath, and they dared not step outside that day into the crowded street for fear the people's hero would be standing in their path. So here's to Eugene the anarchist, who ran the World Trade Organization out of town. Oh yes, three cheers for Eugene the anarchist, that single-handed warrior who shut the bastards down. The riot cops did beat him till their nightsticks all were bent, and they fired their mighty cannons off to make a tear gas haze. But he laughed at them till every tear gas canister was spent, and he upturned 1,000 dumpsters and he set them all ablaze. 20,000 rubber bullets they have fired at him point blank, and he caught them in his teeth as though they were just jelly beans. And he tore the wheels off a police car with just one yank, and the windows of the Nike town he smashed to smithereens. Gallons of their pepper spray they shot into his eyes, and he looked directly at the stream and didn't even blink. And he flattened 3 McDonald's joints and 1 Starbucks franchise, saying, I'd never hurt small business folks, but corporations stink. So here's to Eugene the anarchist, who ran the World Trade Organization out of town. Oh yes, 3 cheers for Eugene the anarchist, that single-handed warrior who shut the bastards down. He smashed the glass of Nordstrom's for selling useless trash manufactured by the military of the Red Chinese. And he waved his magic spray can and a mighty spell he cast that summoned forth an army of green turtles from the seas. And he summoned giant butterflies to swoop down from the air, and cows and clowns and pyramids and disembodied heads. And they sang about a day when all the trading would be fair, while the greedy corporate ministers all hid beneath their beds. He cast the Asian steel off the ships into the bay, and invoked the gods of working folk to shut down all the ports. And he wielded a great wrecking ball and smashed the county jail, and he occupied the naval base and panicked all the courts. He uprooted the Space Needle and he waved it like a wand, and he cast a spell that broke the nation's bank vaults open wide, and he summoned winds that blew the money to the hungry poor, and the working people partied while the parasites all died. So here's to Eugene the anarchist, who ran the World Trade Organization out of town. Oh yes, 3 cheers for Eugene the anarchist, that single-handed warrior who shut the bastards down. Oh yes, hooray for Eugene the anarchist, who ran the World Trade Organization.
colonization out of town. Oh yes, three cheers for Eugene, the anarchist, that single-handed warrior who shut the bastards down.
Several times a year, the ruling corporate and governmental elites come together in exotic locations to decide the fates of nations. They gather under different guises, blinding the world with their alphabet soup. WTO, IMF, FGAA, GATT, NAFTA, the World Bank. These meetings have always been secret, but the agendas have always been the same. With a single-minded focus on destroying the environment and enslaving the workers of the world, their sinister plots have remained unchallenged for years. There's been no democratic process allowed, no public consent required, and absolutely no possible way for your voice to be heard. No way, that is. Until now!
Would you like to shut down the corporate slime and smash up their conference?
Would you like to travel to lovely places like London, Seattle, Prague, and Genoa?
Then come on down to the next anti-corporate globalization protest.
Meet interesting people from around the world and riot with them.
Form friendships and connections that can last a lifetime.
See the beautiful capitals of the world and their correctional facilities.
Are you a winner?
To feel an invigorating sense of power in the midst of extreme chaos?
Then don't wait. Start your direct action project now. And remember, this is an event open to all people of all ages, so bring your friends, bring your family, and bring your neighbors.
I had so much fun at my first protest that for the next one, I brought all of my friends with their gas masks.
I learned a whole new way to use my baseball bat. Boy, they never showed us this in PE.
I met the cutest Greek boy, and he showed me his Molotov cocktail.
Sponsored in part by the Infernal Noise Brigade. Who would ask you to please remember?
Multinational corporations do not collapse by themselves.
They need your help.
Oh, the WPO up to Seattle they did go. They were somewhat naive and did not know. There were people in Seattle that were girded up for battle. They were out to get the WPO. Well, the unions were in motion by the blue Pacific Ocean. They were marching now on pike, or was it fine? They were out there having fun in the bright Seattle sun. They were 30,000 strong and feeling fine. Oh, WTO, how we hate to see you go. Hey, thanks a lot, it's really been a gal. Let us show you to the door. And by the way, there's one thing more. WTO, kiss my hand. Well, his honor may have shelved. Thought he died and gone to hell, and he lost his Christmas spirit then and there. And the king county sheriff didn't care about no tariff, and turtles they were flying through the air. Now Bill Clinton was a guest in that hotel they call the Westin. He was wishing he was elsewhere more and more, 'cause the tear gas was popping and he couldn't do his shopping. And the National Guard was standing round the door. Oh, WTO, how we hate to see you go. Hey, thanks a lot, it's really been a gas. Let us show you to the door. And by the way, there's one thing more. WTO, kiss my ass. Mrs. Albright busted view. She was locked inside a room. Charlie Barshefsky muttered in the hall, 'cause the third world delegations from the disaffected nations didn't go for their agenda, not at all. Now folks on Puget Sound don't like getting kicked around, and they fought back late at night up on the hill. And it wasn't long at all till you could hear the mighty fall, and the WTO. WTO, how we hate to see you go. Hey, thanks a lot. people still remember those fine days in late November when democracy got spelled.